So my presentation will be two parts, mainly on the elephants. We are thinking that elephants and tigers are very important because we have, as a faculty of zoology, we are handling the paper which is known as the ecology paper. Mostly we are handling relevant to your flagship species, keystone species like a biodiversity on the ecosystem, relationships, food chain, food web, and so on. So in which there are so many species will play major role. As you all know that the government of India having two projects sponsored by the central government of India. One is Project Tiger, which has been introduced by government of India during 1973. After that, the government of India having another project, which is called as the Project Elephant. The Project Elephant, which has been launched by government of India during 1992-93. So, but earlier they had one more project also, Project Crocodile. But after that, the progress of being a reptiles, crocodile has populated, the population became very high and high everywhere. So it's very difficult to cull the population because they are in the schedule of one of the Wildlife Protection Act. So we cannot cull the population. So now after that, wherever the project crocodile started, the population became very high. So now the project crocodile has been left by Government of India. Now Government of India is running two successful projects. One is Project Tiger and Project Elephant. So this presentation, my presentation mainly focus on the Project Elephant. Why the elephant is important? Why the government of India has given such important attention for the conservation of elephants? That is what we are going to see in my first presentation. And my second presentation, we are going to see about the what are the issues, because every day, whether it is a printing media or a television media, without the elephant news, it will be very difficult we could be able to pass the day. Because every day we are come across anywhere there will be elephant issues. Whether the elephant has killed the person or people have killed the elephants, so many issues on elephants. So without this elephants, there is no media issues now. Every day we are getting the information. So in my presentation, the first presentation is mainly about the why we need to conserve the elephants. Why the Project Elephant is stress upon the conservation of elephants. Entire government, there is a separate wing for the government of India under the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change. They have the separate wing for Project Elephant, in which the DGP, DAG rank of forester, they are the official forest officer who is looking after the elephant conservation across the country. So the elephant research, after 1972, the elephant research was started slowly in India. People started working on elephants after 1970s only, 70, 71, 72 only. So it took almost 20 years for the government of India to understand about the elephant conservation. That is the result, the 92-93, the government of India launched Project Elephant for conservation of the elephants. So why we people are conserving elephants? That is my first question. That my first presentation will answer for it. So today what we are hearing the news everywhere, as I told you, whether it is a printing media or television media, the elephant people are using for elephants for joyride, or people are elephants using for log transporting here and there, we go to Thailand and all. If you see about the elephant issue, like in Coimbatore, in many places of Tamil Nadu and the other northeast, central India and all, elephants are confronting with the people. So these are the reason elephants are being conserved now. These are the reason the elephant to be conserved. If the question is asked like this, the question is not for, the question is no. Elephant is being conserved mainly because they are terrestrial giant. Elephant is called a terrestrial giant because we may be having blue whale or sperm whale in oceans, but in the terrestrial, the terrestrial region, the elephants are the major animal. It's like a big animal. Being a herbivore, it's not a carnivore also. Being a herbivore, see that the massive animal, massive size, No, I think no one will say they may not like elephants. Everyone will like elephants. So talk from child to adult. So terrestrial, big animal. We have two species of elephants in the world. One is African elephants and another is Asian elephant. We have about three subspecies of Asian elephants and two subspecies of African elephants. Mainly the African elephants, they differentiated depending upon their dental formula, because the elephant have the teeth. The elephant have the teeth which doesn't grow as like a human being from down to up. The elephant teeth, they grow from back to front. That is a very important thing, elephant, the dental formula or dental teeth growth. The elephant teeth grows at the back. When it matures, it comes front and they fall down. So through the year, the elephant teeth will grow 6 times. At a time, you could be able to see a pair of teeth in the lower jaw and a pair of teeth on the upper jaw. But sometime, occasionally, we could be able to see the new teeth, which is on the back, and the previous teeth, maybe whether it is a full shape or often fallen or half fallen and all, we could be able to see the front. So at a time, we could be able to see pair. At the rare time, we could be able to see at least the half of tip of a new one and the old one. So based on the dental formula, African elephants are classified. Asian elephants are classified based on the size and shape and their geological region, because there are population which has been isolated in Sumatranus, in Sumatra Island. They are calling us, we are Elephants maximus Sumatranus, a small population. And the Elephants maximus indicus and the Elephants maximus maximus is the Indian and the Western Ghats. Still our Sri Lankan population, mostly our northeast countries like in Myanmar, Thailand and all. But we have, but recently we had a meeting last previous couple of years before, we had a meeting at Malaysia. We are going to have one more subspecies, which is Asian elephants, Elephas maximus borneensis. There is a Bornean island in Malaysia. They have the population. The animals are very shorter than what normal life of the animals. Even 5 to 5.5 feet is a maximum adult male, like that. Because we have been taken there, we saw the elephants in mostly Malaysia, the Bornean Islands. So that the elephants may be another substitute we will be getting. So once that comes also, we will be having another fourth one. Still, we have one more species, not the species. We have the elephant population at Andaman and Nicobar Islands, but that is not, we cannot say as a subspecies or a separate species of Asian elephant. They are feral elephants, because the elephants have been taken by British people for timber purpose, timber logging purpose. So after the Second World War, the people have been taken, many elephants, but some of the elephants they could not be able to. So the leftover elephants, they became like wild. Now they became like a feral elephants. So whatever the elephants we are seeing in the Andaman Nicobar, all the feral elephants, we cannot say as a subspecies or a new species of elephants. This is a forest cover in India. We have, normally we suppose to have about 33% of forest cover. We suppose to have for any country, for wealth, good wealth. But still we are reaching for it to get a good forest cover. This is a distribution of forest cover from central to south India. So we are having plateaus, steep slopes. Mainly we are having the western parts is very important. And eastern Ghats is very important for South concern. When you see that South India, we have about four landscape populations, elephant population concerned. Nilgiri Vainagh landscape is one of the important landscape population, which is considered to be the single largest Asian elephant population in the world, because we have about 8,000 to 10,000 elephants in contiguous 12,000 square kilometers in the Nilgiris and the Vainagh landscape. So genetically also that seems to be a healthy population. After that, there is a Palghat gap, which has lost so many lengthy corridor. Then we have the Anamalai landscape, Anamalai Parambikulam, the second largest Asian elephant population, the southern belt. Then Periyar landscape, then another population. And southern belt at the tip of population, like the Tirunelveli, Kalakada, Mundurai of Tamil Nadu side, and Thermala forest division, Papara Valley, Senchandi, Kerala side, we have the final last population. So these are the four populations we have in southern India, the elephants populations in western Ghats, southern western Ghats. So this is if you see that this lighter shade is the positive distribution of the elephants. The darker slides, the dark shade are the present distribution of elephants. Still, we have good population of elephants in the world. We have around 13 countries, we have the Asian elephant population. Around 45,000 to 50,000 elephants we are having. This is, you know, but when compared to African elephant population, this is one third only. African elephants are around 1,50,000 and above. But we have around 45 to 50,000 Asian elephants distributed across 13 countries of the world. Very interesting that within that population, India is having the 50% of the world population, which is around 27,000 elephant population in India. In which is very interesting of the South India, that within that, among the Indian population, 50% of the elephant population are in Southern India, especially Western Ghats and Eastern Ghats. We have around 14,000 to 15,000 elephants in Southern India. So that is what is our India is contributing very important role for elephant conservation. If the people who are working on elephants also, India have to see that most other people work on elephants, various aspects when compared to other northeastern countries like, you know, Indonesia, Sumatra, and Thailand. If you go there, people have worked a little bit various smaller aspects. But in India, if you see that various aspects has been extensively worked, whether it is a concrete or ecology or feeding behavior, breeding biology, or communications, or corridor management, so many things have people worked. Even I have worked on elephant corridor management, because I worked in the elephants are using the corridor, how the elephants are using the corridor, when they want to use the corridor, which season is very important for the elephants. These are the things. So most of the studies, if you see that elephants people, they work in India. So this is the Indian population. As I told you, that this is a typical figure which you are getting idea about the forest cover with the elephant distribution. This is what I told. We have the population. South India having around 15,000 elephants when compared to Indian population. So this is a little glimpse of the social organization of the Asian elephants. Elephants, we are calling as a matriarchal society. Only the adult female lead the family, not male lead the family. So that is why the elephant family is called a matriarchal society. It's a matriarch. The oldest female only lead the family. Generally, adult males, they attain the age maturity and they at the age of around 14 to 15 years old. Females attain the maturity first cycle, first estrous cycles, the female attains. Females still withstand with the natural family. But only thing, after 15 years old, the male supposed to split from the natural family. They should go out from the natural family. So after 15 years, that all the male bulls, they join together till 25 years old, they form a bachelor group. As like our boys, no? They are like, you know, they form a bachelor group. In a bachelor group, you could be able to say maximum 8 to 10 individuals in Asian elephants maximum. So I have seen in Africa 38 males in a one bachelor group also. So this is depending upon the area, but the communication between the individuals. So after 20, 25 years, this is a very important role for male elephants. After attaining must, they fight each other, then they will split. This is the general social organization of the elephants. If you see about the elephant family, what is the family? Elephant family defines the female and its dependent calf is called as a family, not a male. Then family, then slowly it's called as a family next to herd. Herd means only the blood related male. This year calf, the joint over, they form as a herd. Then they form one or two natural families, blood related families, they join together, is called a family. After the herd, there's a family. Then family join together, and this is called as a clan. Clan is the congregation of or mixing of all blood related individuals, is called a clan. So the clan, 40 individuals, 6 individuals, and sometimes you will get more than 100 also. Generally, the migration takes place by the clans, not by the family, herd, or other individuals. They generally, the clan, they move from one area to other area. That's called migration, is takes place by the clan. So role, why the elephants to be conserved? That is what we are going to see now. Elephants, as you all know, that the elephants is a continuous feeder. It's a big animal. Everybody know that highly demanding animal. Elephant has to feed 5 to 10% of the body weight every day. So it's a herbivore. Every day it has to feed around 200 to 250 kilogram of biomass day, if the adult male or female individuals. But is it possible the elephant they get all the 200 to 250 kilogram of biomass within a place or small area? So they don't move. So to get every day to procure 200 to 250 kilogram biomass, they will have to walk around 15 to 20 kilometers in a day to get to procure the enough biomass. So digestion also is a long system of the digestive system the elephants are having. It's a single stomach animal, non-ruminant, that means absence of rumen. So the long intestine itself, 178 meters long intestine, around 47 to 48 meters of the small intestine. So whatever the animal eats, it passes through the long tract of the alimentary canal. So when they whatever they eat, it will be defecated only after the second day or third day. So by the time the animal would have crossed the many forest areas. So what does it says? They dispose the seeds because they are the poor digested animal, as I told, non-ruminant, absence of rumen, they come not able to macerate. So whatever they eat, only the 40 to 50% of the food get digested. Rest of the things, they will be defecated as a dung. So all the seeds, whatever they eat, the seeds cannot be digested. The seeds will be defecated. So when the elephant passes through, move through one forest to other forest areas, they disperse the seed from one forest to other. So we are calling as the seed dispersal agent in the forest. Also, the elephants are the animal, they can push down any big tree in the forest. So whatever they push down, they eat very smaller parts here and there. The leftover parts also eatable by the other herbivores. So what the elephant does, it facilitates the food resources to synchronize the other herbivores. That is what, because they see the deer cannot get to procure leaves from the standing tree. But when the tree is pushed down, it will be easy for the animals to get it, other herbivores. Then grazing lawns, they are forest type, you know, like swamps are there. When the grass grows much higher and higher, right, it is not useful for any animals. So elephants continuously feed on that and maintain the height. So that is what is maintaining the lawn, grazing lawn. So the grazing lawn will be useful for next season for the other herbivores. So these are where the elephants are facilitating food resources to the sympatric other herbivores. That is very important. This is what, as I told, no? This is the elephants that have the poor digestive system. They disperse the seeds. We have recorded almost 28 to 30 species of seeds dispersed by elephants in the southern Indian landscapes. So all the seeds, they grow. One of the scientific research studies, they says that in a year, an adult elephant can disperse about 36,000 seeds through the 1 year. So 36,000 is a massive. Even one third, if it germinates, is good enough in the forest. So forests can recoup easily. We may think that the elephants are pushing down the trees, but still that elephants are helping for seed germination and is also helping for seed dispersal. The elephants generally, they will not stick on to any habitat throughout the year. They will keep on move because, as I told, you know, elephants are poor digested animal, absence of rumen. So they cannot macerate water. So they eat only the palatable food, very, very soft and the fresh leaves only they can eat continuously. So is it possible to get any fresh leaves throughout the year from the forest areas in single forest and given point of time in or throughout the year? Is it not at all possible? Maybe you will get 2 to 3 months, a forest may provide fresh green grasses. So after the third month or fourth month, the grasses become very coarse in content. They become maturity. So by the time, it may not be palatable for the elephants. So what the elephant does, they separate and through the year, every season, they will go to different type of forest to procure very fresh green leaves and other twigs or branches. So they spend a different type of forest. Like, you know, they spend the diseases forest, like mice diseases forest, grasslands, and sometimes in the savanna type of forest, they spend more time also. During summer, they spend more time to the bamboo breaks and somewhere in the thorn forest also. The thorn forest is plays vital role for elephants, especially during dry season, because they get more bark, twigs, so many things from the we are calling as a browsing. Instead of grazing, they spend more time, they get different varieties of food in the thorn forest. Sometimes the elephants also, they climb up to the high altitude areas, like, you know, more than 2000. This kind of movement may not be by families. They are mostly by the loners, like, you know, tuskers or tuskless mates. Generally, they move upwards to higher elevation areas because the pregnant females and milking mothers, they will not climb such a huge high areas because they negotiate the steep terrain when they come down. So this is the way the elephant will separate throughout the year. They may not stick on, they may not confine to any forest habitat throughout the year. They keep on move. That is also one way it is important for the elephants, and the other way it is also important for the forest. Because if you just imagine that, the elephant-like animal, if it is pocketed any given area, what is going to happen? They can make severe damage on the vegetation. They can push all the trees. If this continues, what is going to happen? Because in a given area, elephants only are not living. There are so many animals are living, sharing this the food chain and food web. You know, there's connectivity in the ecosystem. So being an ecosystem, elephant-like, you know, severe damage animals, they cannot be pocketed. They should move every season. Then when the forest can recoup, they can support for next year, the elephant comes back. And also the other animals, also those who are depending on the forest, they could be able to also shine well. So that is what very important, the elephant should move. As I told, next, the must. Must is very important behavior. Must is the very important annual physiological phenomena which occurs for the male elephants. Every year, the male, after the attaining maturity, mostly though they attain the maturity at the age of 15 years old, that due to the testosterone hormone influence, the elephants attain must after 20, 25 years. That means nothing but the must is very important behavior. There's a gland, the elephants are having the temporal region. The gland swells and it produces liquid, liquid, semi-liquid, which flows from the gland. This animal will be more aggressive, but more time they spend to mate in search of estrous females only. They reduce the time for grazing or feeding and something. They spend more time. This is called must. This is a restless behavior. It is more urge for to mate and to successful breeding only. This happens. And the elephant dung is a very important hub for many mushrooms and so many things will come out. Because if you see the elephant dung, undigested material, is acting as a artificial mushroom. If you go for us the next day, the second day or third day, you could be able to see the mushrooms will come up in the elephant dung pile. So after this elephant, the mushrooms comes out, there are so many animals, like, you know, varanas and tortoises, so many animals, they feed on that. So elephant dung provides a very important mushroom for the other animals, like reptiles, like varanas, tortoises. Sometimes the sloth bear also and porcupine, they are feeding on these mushrooms. Then the elephant dung pile is a very important hub for the butterflies and the other insects. The dung beetles, especially the dung beetles, the second day, third day, you could be able to see more dung beetles in the elephant dung pile. So when the dung beetles comes out, more insect owners boast, like, you know, peacock and other so many boast, myna, they will feed on the dung beetles. Similarly, the butterflies use the elephant dung piles for getting minerals. When I inquired to the more entomologists, they were saying that the male butterflies, they get more minerals to strengthen their spermatogonal cones, so many things. Female butterflies, they get minerals from the or calcium from the elephant dung pile or the elephant urine to get their shell thickness. So elephants and the butterflies and the beetles are very important. When you see that the migration, elephant migration and butterfly migration, generally it coincides, mainly because they are depending on the resource sharing animal from the elephant dung pile and the elephant urine. Water is very important for elephants because, as I told, the elephant is a thick skinned animal, pachyderm, we are calling as a pachyderm. The skin thickness is 2.5 to 3 mm thickness. So blood vessels are going down. So the elephants could not be able to tolerate in the water course and many places. So when they go to the water hole, what happened? After drinking the water, they releases the, when the stomach become full, automatically, when the water become making the stomach full, immediately they releases this dung in the water hole. They may not know that this is the same water hole which are going to use for next day. They may, but you know, they may not being animal. After drinking the when the stomach is getting full, they release the dung pole in the water holes. So when the dung pores, all the, as a zoology, we all know that all the animals, they have the endoparasitic load, whether in the form of the egg or in the form of the worms, we have the, all the animals, they have the endoparasitic load. So when the dung comes out, it may be having more worms or eggs of the endoparasites. That will be fed by the fish community, because the, after dung pores releases into the water source, the fish community immediately, they're feeding on the egg and the worms of the endoparasites. So next, when they settle down, there is a tadpole, you must be knowing, the amphibian. The tadpole, they simply feed on the chlorophyll content which is left over on the whatever the elephant undigest material. So whatever the elephant releases dung pile in the water hole, which is benefited by the fish community as well as the amphibian community. This is very important. Hydrogeological salt licks is very important. The salt licks is very important for the herbivores, because whenever the animal feels there is a mineral deficiency, there is a, naturally it is available in the forest areas. But only thing, this natural, these minerals from salt licks are, which may not be available on the top side, maybe 1/2 feet or 1 foot, sometimes you know, 2 feet also, it may be available on the bottom of the soil. The elephants is, the elephant trunk is made up of more than like of nerves. So by smelling on the ground, the elephant could be able to sense and detect where are the salt licks are there. Once the salt licks are detected by the elephants, the female use 4 feet and the trunk and to dig on the thing and they feed. Sometimes the male use the tusk to open the ground and they feed on that. So one thing, after they feeding on the, after enough they feed the minerals or salt licks, then they moves out, that will be useful by other herbivores like, you know, monies, deer, and gaur, the bison or gaur, or many herbivorous animals, they will come and eat the minerals on the salt licks in the forest areas. So in the forest areas, elephants are the first detector who can detect the mineral salt licks in the forest areas. Subsequently, it is being used by the other animals. So elephants facilitate the sympatric herbivores to get the mineral resources. However, this is very important, the subsoil water, because during a dry season, severe pinch hours, the elephants, you know, as I told you, know, elephants are thick skin, they could not able to bear the temperature. So what they do, they could be able to, when they are working on the dry stream beds, we may not know that there is a water flow underneath of the dry stream bed, but the elephant could detect there will be water flow underneath of the dry stream bed. The simple strategy each follow. For example, if there is a full of water, if you make a sound, you will get a different sound vibration. If there is empty of water, there is an empty pot. If you make a sound, you will get a different sound. So this, based on this vibration, the elephant could be able to find out whether there is a water flow underneath of the dry stream or there is no water underneath. So one that is detected by the elephants, may not, this water may not be enough for the animals to drink, because the elephant need around 100 to 250, 200 liters of water per day. But what they do that? To spend the pinch summer, you know, high temperature hours, they mix as like a clay, like they apply mud bath. They take mud bath on that. So when they take mud bath, after 3 o'clock, then they move from the, when they leave the place, if you see that how many subsoil water, it is full of water, because water will be stored in that areas, which is more than enough for even tiger to drink, or many birds will drink, other herbivores will drink. So the subsoil water, which is detected by the elephants, which is benefited by the other animals, not only by herbivores, not only for the herbivores, even carnivores use the water. So elephants, whatever the ecosystem for forest, for themselves, which also facilitate or beneficial to other animals. See, this is many subsoil water, when you go that way, after when the elephant moves, when you go there, you could be able to find out different indirect evidences like hoof marks, pug marks, other animals which are used that day, subsoil water areas. If you see that the war, all the forest areas, all the roads in the forest areas, the elephants are the chief engineers in the all the forest areas, because the elephant body is such a way they could be able to negotiate which terrain they could be able to climb, which terrain they could not be able to climb. Because all the roads in the ghat areas, if you go there, all the bus routes or railway tracks, even for if you take up the Nilgiris, there is a railway track which goes from Mettupalayam to Ooty. This gradient, the people use only the elephant footpaths to put the railway track. So elephants are the chief engineer for all the roads in the forest areas. And other important things, all the roads in the elephants, all the footpaths of the elephants, mostly it ends up with the water bodies. So even there are many animals, they use the elephant footpaths, because all the elephant footpaths, it ends up with the water holes. So the herbivores, other animals, when they started their search of water, they used to follow the elephant footpaths to get their water sources. Another important thing is, like, because nowadays there is a huge problem everywhere. Everywhere there is a invasion of various invasive alien species like Lantana camara, and the foreign the plant which has been introduced for various purposes in the earlier days, now they introduced into the forest, they invaded into the forest ecosystem. They covered entire area. It has been occupied ground cover, the middle cover of the forest areas. So now nobody can see what is happening inside the forest areas because of the invasion of exotic weeds. So when one herd of elephants, when it passes through that, because elephants are a huge weight animal, the pad is something like, you know, an instrument. So when it passes through any bush or any thick invasive species area, they could be able to make paths, footpaths. So these are the footpaths also being used by all the carnivores like tiger, leopard, hyena. They are the nocturnal users. They use them, they mostly walk on the elephant footpaths to get their prey. So wherever the elephants are good in the forest ecosystem, it has benefited not only for the herbivores, it has also benefit to the carnivores. See, most of the tiger and leopard, they use elephant footpaths to procure their prey materials, like, you know, if it's a small prey, deer or antelope, they could catch only from when they walk through the elephant footpaths. So actually the elephants play a vital role, not only for the herbivores, they also very important, they play a vital role for the even carnivores. That is the reason now the elephants are being called as a keystone species. Because we know ecology, we because we have the core syllabus of ecology.